I'll only run and hide. Who can it be now?
Very proud to be joined by, and I'm reading the bio of James Chernowski. He's been involved in antitrust policies, big tech. He spoke before Congress, policy analyst. Free market think tank. I mean, this guy sounds like I'm going to love him. I believe he's a capitalist. Let's bring him on. James, how are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks. How are you doing?
Very good. It's so nice, James. I mean, am I right? I'm assuming you're a capitalist.
I definitely love capitalism. It's a great system.
I know we have to be shy. I know we have to be quiet. I know we're not supposed to talk about it, but it's so nice to meet a free market capitalist. I mean, I'm almost just astonished that you're willing to come on and speak about it.
Yeah, no, I'm glad that you're willing to have me to talk about it. I think it's an important issue, so I'm definitely happy to be here.
So I got a lot of things I want to talk to you about. First of all, you've written recently about the Fairness Doctrine. Now, this is an interesting thing. To me, this is the bastardization of freedom and the backdoor nationalization of airwaves. And my understanding was we took care of it. Is it back?
Well, I mean, there certainly seems to be an ironic desire from Republicans to bring it back because they feel like they're being censored unfairly by these tech companies. And it, like I said, it is kind of ironic that Republicans are pushing for this Fairness Doctrine, because it was back in the 60s where you saw JFK really weaponize this doctrine of the Fairness Doctrine from the FCC to go and really put an end to a lot of popular conservative talk show radio. So it's starting to try to maybe come back through these different proposals to amend or change what's known as Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act in some way or another. So it's very important to go and see.
And the really ironic part is it was Reagan that killed it. And Reagan is you know, he's spoken by the Republicans in some cases right, in some cases wrong, where he's a deity for the Republicans. And now the Republicans are trying to bring it back, because the reality is they do believe, after a lot of their nonsense policies, this is the perfect bear trap to get the support of the people and then use it against freedom and promote their propaganda. Don't you think?
Yeah, and like I said, I think that this is a very unfortunate step and a miscalculation by Republicans, because in advocating for something like this, I think that it could severely backfire and actually hinder conservative values and conservative traditions that they want to go and embody, whether that's freedom of speech or freedom of idea and expression. By having this Fairness Doctrine, you're literally watering down that conversation to be, you know, relatively dull by comparison to what we can have today.
And it's almost in the same way as when you watch these frauds who all of a sudden have self-righteousness, like Zuckerberg, come on and demand that the government regulate the internet more. Because what he's really asking for is the bastardization of regulation to protect against competition. In the same fashion, Bezos pretends to do a mea culpa and come out and say, I must have put out too many mom and pops, rather than hope for a free market solution and competition, and the government falls for it every time, James. Do we stand a chance against it, or is it just a matter of time?
It's really hard to say right now what it looks like. I think that you kind of see Facebook and Twitter and a lot of these companies coming of age when they go from being the disruptors to becoming like more the incumbent position, where they're like they're in favor of some kind of regulation, and Facebook's not necessarily even shy about looking for that. But at the same time, too, I think that they're just trying to really, you know, orchestrate this delicate balance, because I feel like they got put into this trap where, you know, in 2016, after Trump wins, there's a lot of calls for them to start trying to regulate political speech. And unfortunately, that's just like a nasty trap to fall into, because most politicians, as you know, are not necessarily the most honest folks. So regulating political speech is going to most certainly go and try to put some people, leave them in an unhappy position as a result of how you're trying to moderate that content, right?
Yeah.
So it's not to be in at all.
Well, what makes me nervous, James, I have to be honest with you, what makes me nervous is how many ex-Tea Party people, how many old Republicans, old conservatives have fallen into this trap of really nationalization of our trade, have fallen into the trap of the nationalization of our banking, and support the massive, massive increase in spending and debt and stimulus. So I'm worried, because in my opinion, your specialty is the last frontier of any kind of freedom and liberty, in particular you know, our ability to kind of grow out of it will come from the internet.
Well, you're absolutely right. Right, that was kind of what made the internet possible, was the fact that back in the 90s, when we created Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act, we knowingly set this notion that the United States was going to be hands off with the internet and create and facilitate an environment where people could go and express themselves in truest form. For better or worse, that's what we ended up getting, was this really wide open, really diverse network of opportunities for people to go and exchange ideas in a way that they've never been able to do so before. And that's really something that you've got to appreciate. And I think that older Republicans really, you know, would be rolling in their graves to go and see some of the things that this more populist version of the Republican Party is taking these days, like you said, whether that's nationalizing banks or looking at the spending side of the equation or just this America First, like jobs kind of thing that they're trying to do. There's just so many aspects that certainly raise some alarm.
So, James, let me ask you, Senator Josh Hawley, what did he propose?
Oh, well, Senator Hawley has offered a couple of different solutions to Section 230, particularly trying to deal with this perceived bias against conservative voices. One of those things was to try and take a particular section out of Section 230 and move it more up in the document to go and list out their policies, particularly, and then hold companies liable if a consumer felt like they were not moderating in a balanced and fair manner. And, you know, as an economist and somebody who's looked at a lot of frivolous lawsuits, this is just like a trial lawyer's like wet dream, right? Like they see this and they're like, oh my God, I can go and take Facebook to the cleaners with this. And it's very unfortunate to see. That's a very sad state to go and try to put the internet in.
James, would you mind staying with me through the break? I've got a couple more questions I want to ask you about the future, about our economy. Do you mind staying?
Absolutely.
Thank you so much, James. We'll be back after this with James Chernowski. Thank you for listening. Thank you for staying with us. James Chernowski, thank you for hanging on the line. I really appreciate it. I want to ask you something that's been bothering me. I get in a lot of arguments with a lot of people, James, but I don't waver ever because I recognize the failure and fraud and misrepresentation and abuse of the antitrust laws. And the reality is, this is government's favorite weapon to extort businesses, to control businesses' growth and their ability to achieve things. And I see this coming out of the woodwork enchanted. And I'm wondering, are they going to fall into the trap and give Bezos exactly what he wants and use antitrust to assure his perceived monopoly, but his brokerage of and extortion of small businesses? Because that's the way that Amazon really works, versus allowing people to come together and start their own.
Well, I mean, unfortunately, what we saw at the antitrust subcommittee hearing last week was most unfortunate. You had both Republicans and Democrats really utilizing this hearing that was meant to talk about antitrust to talk about anything but that. And then the limited cases where they did, it was really citing improper things. And you know, they couldn't possibly give answers here. But the problem is that if they try to go and shift away from antitrust standards that we have right now, which is based on consumer welfare, to something that's more societally based or something different, there's actually a very good chance that a lot of Americans will be left worse off because they won't have as many access to choices that they would otherwise have. So I think that there's a very alarming thing that we're seeing developing right now in the United States with respect to antitrust and trying to weaponize it in this fashion.
Are you shocked at the amount of Americans that couldn't get through an Econ 101 class? I mean, I'm talking businessmen. I'm talking people who raise families. I am astonished that we have been really kind of trapped in this quicksand of socialism where our choices are really different degrees of socialism versus the foundation of our country, which is the property rights of and freedom of capitalism. And do you see us correcting this in our lifetime, or are we just going to ease in like an old man to a tub of tyranny?
I think that I don't think that we're just going to ease into a tub of tyranny, so to say. I think that there's a lot of Americans that are very cognizant and aware of what happens if we just keep giving and acquiescing power to the state or to these different institutions. So I'm not necessarily on that side of it. I think that there's a question to be had about how people are learning economics, because even if you are in a lot of colleges and universities, maybe it's not necessarily the most free market oriented kind of style of learning that you're going to have. So perhaps that might present its own unique problems in and of itself. And, you know, it's very reflective in the way that we talk about things today, whether that's like AOC's interpretation of how market power works or whatever, right? So I think that is very alarming, but I don't think that it's a lost cause. I think that there's a lot of young people that are seeing this and are trying to go and rectify it. But really what matters is that they have to be able to recognize it and then be able to talk about it, more importantly, because people that are, you know, more prone to wanting socialist things, they have no problem going and advocating for it whatsoever. And I just wish that some, you know, free market principle people would be equally as strong in their ambition to want to go and talk about these ideas too.
With the result and the consequences of this last year due to the what I think is an outrageous economic shutdown enforced by government on the people, and the reality of how it's destroying the youth and their options, their opportunities, and now that they're really, you know, my daughter, I sent her back to college not just because I think she's going to utilize it, but because I understand at 19, there's really nothing out there for her to do unless she has all of those degrees and benefits. It's not like when I was young, where you could go out and make your living. These kids now are seeing massive increases in their costs. Both their rents are going up, their tuition is going up, and the inflation that is, we're pretending, isn't there in their consumption of things. Do you think they're going to turn to the abuser with the Stockholm syndrome and say, please, government, help me, like the Bernie Sanders people? Or do you think this is the time for us to maybe lure them into the correct answer of true economic growth?
Well, I think that a lot of students right now feel like they are going into this system that doesn't necessarily repay them for the investment that they're putting in, right? So a kid that's going to Harvard this fall, and it's going to be completely online, by the way, they're keeping their tuition at $50,000, and, you know, they're going to get a degree in something, and the value of that degree and the job it might lead to might not actually equate to, you know, them being able to pay off that student loan that they've done. So, yeah, you've seen a lot of young people go and advocate for the Bernie Sanders-style thing of canceling student college debt and all that, and I think that that's very alarming. But I think that the solution, when you're going forward, is not to, you know, not to fall into that trap. It's to actually advocate for alternative options. Like, you do not have to go to college in order to get a high-paying job these days. Like, especially, like, if you're trying to get into technology, right? Mm-hmm. Or even, like, healthcare. You can literally go to, those technical schools, like BOCES or whatever, and get, you know, specific training towards becoming a nurse or whatever, right? And that can only lead you for a much lower cost, a much better quality life as a result, which means that you're paying off debt sooner, you can go and grow wealth, et cetera, et cetera.
James, I got 15 seconds. Can you give me a website where people can find you?
Yeah, sure. You can go and see my work on www.libertasutah.org. That's where I go and I post a lot of my stuff, as Wonderful. Well as on the Young Voice website.
James Chernowski, thank you so much for joining me. I'd love to have you back. Thank you again. We'll be back after these messages.